of CG Partners, a six-time Inc. 500 company. So Sam, come on up. Yes. Flomo Burnman is the founder of 26 Flavors, the fastest growing coffee company in the US, and will share their wisdom and growth on this panel discussion. Thank you, Flomo. Charles Wolfsky is the head of business development at Barolo, one of the fastest growing fintech companies based here, right? Thanks, Charles. And Ryan Halper is the vice president of finance and global investment strategy for Costa Consulting, the fast growing ad tech consulting firm with presence in over 24 countries. So, first of all, I apologize if I butchered any of your names. I did my best. I have dyslexia, and when I read stuff, it doesn't always work out the way I inclined to, so I apologize for that. So why don't we just go straight down the line, and let's start with just tell me a little bit about your company, what you do, and maybe one growth strategy that you find to be very effective for how you've grown your business.
I'm Sandy Webster. My company is CDG Partners. We provide marketing and analytic consultants.
Can we affect the volume or no? Can we affect the volume of the mics? Okay, so then what I'm gonna do is, we have another microphone too, right? So I'm gonna use both handhelds and just pass them down.
Okay. I'm Sandy Webster and my company, CDG Partners. We provide marketing and analytic consultants to Fortune 500 companies, mainly in financial services, telecom, and insurance. We do have some healthcare, but those are the three main verticals. My company has been on the Inc. list for growth, which is, we're very thankful. It's a feat to accomplish. We're only six times, there are companies who are way more than that. But in order to achieve and sustain that growth, we've introduced technology. We're a marketing company, and marketing, I joke and say, it's not your grandparents' marketing anymore. Every marketer must use several pieces of technology, and they're getting younger and younger and younger because they're very, very technology driven. And so we've had to hire, when we started our company, we joked that you had to have gray hairs to be a part of our company, and my gray hair. But now we've had to do a complete transformation. We still have the very tenured seasoned marketers who've had to learn new skills and new how to use technology to do the marketing. But we've also brought in the new millennials, the new generation of marketers who knows how to use technology to their advantage. And so that's how we've been growing and scaling, is by wedding and marrying those two generations of marketers, the strategic and the execution of marketing with the technology.
Thank you.
My name is Shlomo Bergbaum. I'm president of company 26 Flavors. We are a marketing and distribution company for beverages online. It's called e-commerce. The bet that we are making is that in the future, you're going to be able to target a very specific audience. So as opposed to other companies that target everyone, what we've done is we've developed brands that target a very specific audience, and we market the heck out of it to those people, and hopefully get return on loyalty. We don't have to charge, you know, it's not a commoditized item, it separates us, it's a differentiating factor. So everything's about scale online and marketing to a very, very specific audience.
Hi, my name is Charles Olofsky. I'm the head of business development at the World Global Limited. We're a company down the hall, we showcased here at Bronx. Our vision, company's vision, is to try to the best of our abilities to eliminate fraud and provide everyone with a digital identity. Essentially, the problem that we're facing is fraud is an identity theft is a reality, and Equifax is latest large breach where over 100 million people have lost their personal data. What we do is we try to secure transactions by using the phone number as an economic identifier, and then at the time of a transaction or login, we'll send the person a four-digit PIN, a request for a four-digit PIN over their phone. And this is an ATM-like experience where we ask for it over a secure channel called USSD. So even if where all other fraud prevention tools are coming over the internet, we have a multi-factor, what we call a multi-channel approach, where this is a secure session, bypasses the operating system. We proved that our technology in emerging markets, and we now, our growth strategy is by approaching central banks in different markets that we approach, and they show us the banks, and we take a direct licensing approach to our technology.
Brian Halpert, I'm at Prohaska Consulting. Prohaska Consulting is the largest programmatic consulting firm in the world. Programmatic is a form of advertising. It's high-speed ads. It's making digital and online, using data, thinking RTB and DMP and a bunch of other acronyms that some of you may know and some of you may not. It's pretty much the next generation of advertising. Our companies range from Fortune 500 companies to startups to private equity firms and universities. Strategies for growth is always just putting out great content. That means if you're on an engagement and you're developing a deck, it's basically doing a great job giving actionable intelligence. Just having people be able to say that you did a great job, people tell their other clients, their other friends, their other people they know in the industry, that you've done a great job. We have a Prohaska Perspectives email marketing campaign, whereas when we see something important is happening in the marketplace, whether it's the changing of how Congress is going to treat ad spend as a taxable entity, or if there's fraud happening in the marketplace, what's happening to Facebook, we'll give a perspective on it. And when we send it out, we use a system, just move the SAMAI from some of our other systems, puts everything together, decide to work with them. We'll put out whatever we put out has to be great content. So if we're putting out something, that's our first point of contact, even before some of our business development people have a chance to talk to them. It's having that content that's real, that's actually saying something that they want to read, and not just a waste of their time for opening an email or some type of click.
So Brian, since you got the mic, I'm going to stay with you for a second and we'll pass it back down. So programmatic advertising has exploded in the last couple of years. I mean, there's just a ton of platforms, both supply and demand side. So what have you done to stay ahead of your competition?
Well, for us, we're the ones that are usually, as consulting firms, we're in the marketplace. So it's having great people. And that's always the biggest thing, is bringing in the people that know the platforms, that know the systems, whether they're here for 6 months. We have an outsourced system where we can have some contractors. If they have 3 or 4 months to give us, they'll teach us and have trainings. We have the company present twice a week to show us their system, because if you don't know what's going on, you can't really affect it. So they'll give us a review of what their company is, how it works. One thing we've done is we only work on one side of the transaction, so there's been a lot of thing of programmatic original taglines. There's people that would take from both sides of transaction, use your own system. We're only taking one, so when I tell someone, hey, come and present your company to our company, it's not a sales pitch. It's come tell us. So if you're the best solution for any of our clients, we're going to be able to give them the best company, not a company we're going to get kicked back from or something of that nature.
Thank you. Charles, so I understand, so the two-factor security piece has been a huge improvement in terms of being able to avoid some of the fraud that you've identified. But how has marketing played a role in your company's growth, as opposed to just having like a great platform and great security? What kind of marketing has really made a difference for your business?
Well, we take a direct marketing approach. We approach that as a direct sale. So we take a top-down approach by going directly to the senior, the CEO level, or the CSO, CTO, and we showcase our technology. What we also do is we also approached other influencers like security consulting firms. So when we showcase our technology, they really see that our multi-factor and our multi-channel approach, the fact that we're the only company that avoids the internet completely, that is really the most secure approach. And they in turn influence decisions to adopt our technology.
Awesome. Tell me a little bit about sort of as you're looking at continuing competition, where do you see AI playing a role, artificial intelligence being a part of your business? Where do you think it's going to make an impact and help drive business further for you?
Well, I think that AI is happening right now with Amazon, everybody's familiar. They obviously use big data to, as you referred to earlier, track a journey. So a customer comes and checks out an item. They know which item the person checked out, they know which other item the person checked out, they know what they purchased previously. So basically, if we don't use AI, if we don't figure out how to scale with, you know, enterprise solutions that are good for mid-sized companies, we're going to be, our products aren't even going to make it to the consumer. So we have to also bring in technology that we can scale. Instead of just keeping a database, for example, of all our customers and sending them an email once in whatever period, we would actually track the journey, so we would know when the person came to the website, we would know when they emailed, we would know when they, potentially when they shopped on other sites, and we would see when they purchased, and we can map that all out, figure out when they're ready to purchase, and then hit them again. So that's kind of where it's going.
That's awesome, thank you. So Sandy, when you are hitting that the Inc. 5000 list multiple times, what would you say was really required to help you scale your business? Because I think a lot of businesses, they might be able to hit that list one time because they have that initial pop, but you've been there more than once. How have you really used different systems, tools, or whatever your secret is to basically continuing that growth after you sort of hit that initial pop?
Like I said, it's a constant struggle to continue that path of growth. But we always try to think ahead of the curve, like what is next? In our case, it's in marketing, it's in analytics, what is next in that? One thing for us that is our latest is to create an app. So in marketing and in the consulting realm, speed is everything. You're the first person to get there, then you win that contract, you get your consultant on the project, and in our current database, we were using people, recruiters and salespeople. Now we've had to build an app. We started actually with Roz's company to create an app that gives immediate access to our consultants. So it does cut out some of the recruiting that has to be done, but it's the access that's important. So it's Uberizing consultant, for lack of a better word. Making the customer getting there quicker, faster, having the ability to put in their information of what their needs are and really customize the kind of consultant that they need. And that we hope will take us to the next level of growth in our company.
Excellent. Before I ask more questions, does anyone in the audience have a specific question for any of our panelists? Is there any dying marketing or sales related question that you really want someone else to address for you, get their perspective? These industry experts. Yes, sir.
I actually have a question for Charles at Bolero. You know, I've seen Bolero grow in the last, 16 months to a global company. It started up a global company. And you're sharing some of the stories as to how you guys grew. And I think a lot of it had to do with the channels, right, that you went in and kind of working through the banks and some of those channels. Can you share with us your global footprint right now as it stands as to how, you know, what your global footprint is like and how you got to that stage?
Sure. So we actually, I'll first share the global footprint and tell you our mindset on growth and technology. Our footprint right now is South Africa, India, many markets across the Middle East. We're now speaking to markets in Asia as well. We're going to be entering the US, Canada, and South America as well, Central America over the next coming months. We're going to have this So that's our footprint right now. And we're doing it with a relatively lean team. And like I said, we are doing it through the top-down sales approach. So what we're doing is we're licensing our technology to banks. Banks then in turn, even though we're B2C technology, so it's a consumer-facing technology, we're leveraging the bank's customers. We're leveraging the bank's IT infrastructure. We're leveraging the bank's human capital resources. So what we do is we, for instance, let's say we have one licensee that's rolling this out in more than 140,000 locations across India. For us to go ahead and actually implement that technology would take an army, but we're licensing it to a company that has that army and can in turn implement our technology, and all we have to do is train them and provide our technology to sit behind their IT infrastructure, behind their firewalls, in their data centers. And as a consequence, it's a white label licensing agreement where we realize an upfront licensing fee, transaction fee, and an annual maintenance fee. So it's a highly scalable and lucrative model that allows us to have true growth.
Other questions from the audience?
I have a moment.
Yes, please.
So you started, your strategy was to be international first and then come to the U.S. as opposed to the other way that traditional companies here do that.
Yes. What we first did was we tested our technology. It was actually in Afghanistan. It was with 1-800 Flowers in the U.S. military. And it was together with Roshan Telecom. And the idea was we were, besides having a authentication platform, we also have mobile payments, full mobile banking platform. What we're trying to do is provide a payment where the U.S. military would be able to order the family for the loved ones on Valentine's Day and use their phone number. Mm-hmm. After proving that out, then we drafted the patent, which has now been approved in 82 markets in the U.S. And pending in other markets as well. And the reason why we chose Afghanistan and Pakistan and other countries like that is because if a tree falls over there, no one hears it. So you could fail, and it's also, and you could also say it's true, we've been battle tested. But after proving it out over there, then we're taking it, we now have the use cases to then go over to other markets.
Questions? Yes.
Question for Shlomo. So you were talking about kind of using previous transaction data, kind of like the Amazon model, you know, following the journey and understanding like what to have. So I'm just curious, like as an early stage company, how do you think about when you have enough data to kind of be able to act? It's like we're still kind of gathering and watching behaviors and refining our approach to that, and kind of think, so curious to hear how you kind of thought about that process.
That's a good question. I guess when we started, we didn't really have a plan of what to use, you know, and how to use the data. We did know that we had to segment it, you know, create as many different columns as possible, like first name, last name. But we wanted to break up all the data, and then as the technology becomes available, that's when we're deploying it. So we're still continuously looking for AI. It was last year very popular on our ISDEN. So every time somebody types in something on social media, you would get an alert, they would get a thank you, you know. So you can set the whole platform up, but if you're going to build a, you know, at least a B2C business, you have to be keeping an eye on everything in the entire market, and the artificial intelligence side can keep track of that for you.
I have a question for Brian. So Brian, this week and literally today, Facebook, Google, and Twitter were all marched into the U.S. government's office talking about how they need to be doing a better job of patrolling the ads that are coming through their systems and platforms. And since you do programmatic, I'm wondering, you know, are there safeguards or other things you've had to build in from a technology standpoint to help with some of that same thing? So you're going to run into the same problems if you're not careful, right?
There are safeguards. The problem with any startup, which a lot of the companies in programmatic had been 2 years ago, now they're multi-billion dollar companies, is that whether you're doing widgets or programmatic, they would promise what the technology could do and not where it actually was. So where you had 100 million ads going through a system on a monthly basis, that may have been three people. And it may have been two engineers and one salesperson, and all of a sudden they're responsible for 100 billion ad impressions. Fast forward to today, a lot of those controls are getting built in because they have bigger engineering teams. The question isn't going to stop because now you have GDPR being implemented.
Do you guys know what GDPR is?
No.
Okay, that's really important, so we'll get to that next, so keep going.
So GDPR is basically the EU's version of the new data protection laws that the US obviously does not adhere to. But if you were to do the privacy shield, if you go up to a certain level, then you would be okay to trade data with European companies. All these new restrictions are paramount and insanely important. They're coming to the surface. GDPR hadn't been implemented. A lot of people had been doing things for it to see where it land. With what happened with the election, Facebook and Google really moved the market more than anyone else. Google is an ad tech company. All the other stuff we have, it's really an advertising company. That was the Business Week article where it was pretty much make $1 trillion off of ads, and then the rest is all just, who knows. So what they do, I guess it goes with the entire market. Having what happened with Facebook, all the data guards they said they had, or people said they had in place, will now be in place probably within the next 3 months because of GDPR and because of what happened.
Let me just interject here too. So I just published an article on GDPR this last week, and if you guys don't know what GDPR is, you really need to pay attention to it. Even though it's data protection coming out of Europe, if you do any transaction at all with anyone in Europe, you are going to be liable for this new law. And so what ends up happening is US companies don't think that it matters because it's an EU law, but this is the new data privacy protection standard that's going to be rolled out in May of next year. If your systems and architecture are not comprehensive to sort of deal with these new changes, you are going to be open to fines the minute anyone in Europe tries to transact with your website. So this is the problem. I don't want you guys to get blindsided by this, but it's a new level of data encryption. It's going to start with the Facebooks, the Googles, everybody else out there who are global companies. Any global company is already facing this because it was announced almost 2 years ago. But what's going to happen is that you're going to see a new set of standards where consumers are going to expect to be able to control their data from your website. And if you're not doing it, and then they find out that a European has done anything with your website from a data collection perspective, you can be fined, you can be liable. So the thing is with GDPR, even though it's an EU policy, it's absolutely something that everyone in here should be aware of and be making sure that they're in compliance or at least working toward compliance, because you don't want to be caught flat-footed in June when they start policing it. All right?
Just add on to it. If you think it's not going to change the world, if you look at what happened with SMS messaging a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years now, the new rules went into effect where if you didn't have opt-outs and this and that, you had these huge fines. I think everybody here has noticed that you're getting a lot less SMS messages. There's no more fake messages because of that rule and regulation. The same thing's going to happen with GDPR, and the same thing, frankly, is going to happen with once there are a lot of problems, but they're not problems until they become problems. Now that Congress is aware of what's happening and we see how it can affect commerce, there's going to be new laws. You have Randall Rothenberg, who is the head of the IAB, which is the Interactive Advertising Bureau, the Trade Association. He's speaking before Congress this week about it. So there's going to be a lot more self-regulation that's going to happen. You're going to see new rules coming in from all these tech companies. One of the reasons I think they weren't there is because they're still trying to figure out what happened. It's called a lot of people blindsided. So.
We probably have time for two more questions. So if you have a question, now is your opportunity to raise your hand and ask a question. Yes, sir.
Can some of you talk about your approach to using partners to go to market?
The way we use partners to go to market are a couple of ways. One, we use our vendors as partners. So as a marketing company and an analytics company, a lot of times we partner with other people who have the technology. So if there's one of our vendors that have a super cool technology that we need to provide to our clients, like the financial services, we partner that way. And they also have to sell us back to the partner. So it's both a sales and a partnering strategy as well. We also partner with other companies if, let's say, we don't have a consultant with the exact skill set that our clients need. So we'll partner that way and do a share. But our goal is to get our clients the best person, any which way we can. And that's not always the most profitable way, but we make sure we take care of that with our clients.
Am I actually selling to people that are 50 years old and make above $150,000, or should I actually be looking at people that are 32 years old and make $45,000? And having that, it will be able to tell you where your market is. It may not be what you think. And that's one of those things that'll really change. And then you'll be able to say, okay, let's do a data spend here, or let's do a data spend there on our advertising. That's going to change the way business happens.
Thank you. Before we thank our panel here, I just want to make two very quick announcements. We are going to take a 5-minute break right after we dismiss the panel, thank them. And coming back right after the break, we have Ken Lordy, who's the Senior Director of Dun & Bradstreet, a 175-year-old data company that employs four former U.S. presidents. And he's going to share how his business insights and tenant signals fuel growth. We have Scott Seltzer, who's the founder of ConnectMe, an advanced business phone system. He's going to share how seamless call tracking and reporting with your sales systems enables growth. We've got Evelyn Chowdhury, who is the CEO of Office Interactive, an app development firm, which will discuss growth through innovation, how building your own platform is essential for growth in today's economy. Andrew Stein is the co-founder and partner of Vicus? Sorry, I said that wrong. I knew I was going to put the emphasis on the wrong syllable. Sorry about that. Vicus Partners will share insights of New York City real estate, the landscape for growth, and debunking myths. Jeff Alper is the principal from Strategic Growth Benefits. We'll share with us the five pillars of employee benefits to retain good talent and for better growth. And then Keith Reynolds will wrap it up with from Galileo Tech Media. We'll tie it all together with a presentation of branded content and how marketing automation can be leveraged for better ROI. These are all rapid-fire 10-minute presentations. They are tight. And so again, you want to stick around, you're going to get a wealth of information in a very short period of time. So let's thank our panel, the speakers now. Thank you so much.